Hello and welcome to Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night. I'm Pastor Scott Villain with HolyImpactMinistries.com. God bless you and thank you for sharing your time with us here this evening as we move through the introductory portion of the book of Acts. We have just finished up with the book of Romans, and if you'd like to go through that study with us, you can find it at HolyImpactMinistries.com and just click on our Bible Studies tab, and you'll find that study of the book of Romans that we've just finished up with. Now moving into the book of Acts. And the book of Acts is absolutely just an exciting book to go through. There are so many things going on in the book of Acts. Again, this is where the gospel seed of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ our Messiah, was planted. And we can see immediately upon its being planted, as it begins to flourish throughout the land, and we can already see persecution coming upon those early Christians, and we can see the struggles that the early church had. Much of what is going on around the world, even today, in some parts of the world. And this is going to be an extremely exciting book to go through. So we invite you to stick with us during this journey that we're going to go on with the Apostle Paul and men like Barnabas and Stephen and Peter and James. And we're going to learn a little bit about what the Scripture does say and what it doesn't say. I think some of the facts that we have for you today are going to be kind of interesting, to say the least. The book of Acts, again, is where the seed of the gospel message was actually planted. This actual book of Acts comes from, the Acts of the Apostles, comes from one book, the book of Luke. The gospel of Luke and the book of Acts was at one time one book. The early church knew them as one book. The author of this book, called the Acts of the Apostles, was a physician by the name of Luke. And this is important for us to know and to understand. The book of Acts was not written by the Apostle Paul. It was indeed written by Luke. Now, Luke was a physician, a doctor who traveled with Paul at least partially through many of his journeys, setting up new Christian churches all over Asia Minor and in Greece and in Rome. And it is agreed by most biblical scholars that it was indeed Dr. Luke who wrote both the book of the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles. Now, in Colossians 4, 2 Timothy 4, and in Philemon 24, Paul directly mentions Luke as traveling with him in his journey. So we know that Luke was with the Apostle Paul through much of his journeys. Some of Luke's writings are from eyewitness accounts. Other parts of Luke's writings come from documents kept by those who were with Paul and traveled along with him. Now, as I said, the book of Luke, the book of Acts was actually one book. The book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke, and the Acts of the Apostles were one book, and they weren't split into two books until later on. The original book was called The History of Christian Origins, and that's how the early church knew the writings of the physician Luke. They knew it by this one book called The History of Christian Origins. Now, that one book with its two volumes was not broken apart into two separate books until much later on. And then they became known, as we know them in our canon today, the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles. So, interesting information there that you need to know. When Acts was written, this is something else that I find extremely interesting. It was actually written about 64 AD. Now, there are some scholars that believe it could be written as late as 115 AD. But I, and other scholars, believe that it was probably closer to 64 AD for many reasons. One of them being that we know that the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. and so was Jerusalem. So, and we don't see any of that in the writings of the book of Acts. So if Paul would have penned the book of Acts anytime after 70 AD, certainly he would have mentioned the attack on Jerusalem and the demolition of the temple. This was a tectonic global thing that was happening in that time, in that part of the world. I mean, that was a big deal. It wasn't something that Luke would have left out of his writing. So we believe that it was more around 64 AD that he actually had penned this book. Now, who was Paul? In the book of Acts, we're going to find out exactly who Paul is. Paul was a Benjamite. And, of course, you know that the southern tribe of the Benjamins, the Benjamites, and the Jewish people, the house of Judah, were in the southern kingdom when the two kingdoms split. The northern kingdom contained the other 10 tribes and was known as the house of Israel or the house of Ephraim. And then you had the house of Judah, which was down at the bottom. So you had the split of the 12 tribes of Israel. And the Benjamites lived among the Judeans. So Paul, even though he was a Benjamite, came from the tribe of Benjamin, was considered to be a Jew because he came out of the kingdom, the southern kingdom of Judea. So we know that Paul was a Benjamite, and we also know that Paul was a Pharisee who was born in Tarsus, which was the academic capital of the world. And we touched on some of these things in the book of Romans, when we studied the book of Romans. Again, Paul, extremely an intelligent man who had studied Socrates and Aristotle and Plato. He spoke at least three languages that we know of, and he sat at the feet of Gamaliel. Now, Gamaliel was the most revered rabbi of his time, and it was said to even sit at the feet of Gamaliel that you had to have committed the Torah to memory. So Paul himself also was a Pharisee, we find out, and we also know that Paul was considered a Roman citizen. So Acts really is a pivotal point in knowing and understanding who Paul was from the very beginning and how he was selected to be an apostle. And this is an amazing, amazing story. For those of you who do not know anything about Paul, I think you may be surprised at the Apostle Paul and some of the things that he was into before he became a Christian and became a believer. It is important also that we get to know Paul, who is also known as Rabbi Sheol, because it is believed by most biblical scholars that he wrote over two-thirds of the Brit Hadashah, also known as the New Testament. So if you get the writings of Paul wrong, you're going to get over two-thirds of the New Testament wrong. And I may say this, it saddens my heart to say that so many of these young fellows that are coming out of these seminary schools in our modern-day churchianity today has lost track of and lost sight of the true meanings of the writings of the Apostle Paul. And we will bring those to light during this particular study as well. It's important, I think, at this point in time to just know and to understand something very profound that we see even in Christianity today, in our modern-day version of Christianity. Paul was one of the men that we might say had more degrees than a thermometer. I mean, this man was extremely intelligent. He came from the academic capital of the world. He was well-versed in Aristotle, Plato, Socrates. He was a Pharisee. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel. He could speak three different languages. Here's Paul, and he is highly educated, highly educated. And he does not even understand who the Messiah is. Here is this man running around like a chicken with his head cut off, killing Christians and throwing them in jail, has no idea who the Messiah is. He himself is a Pharisee. And we remember, if we remember in the book of Matthew, in the 23rd chapter of Matthew, how our Messiah felt about the Pharisees and the scribes and the Pharisees. Again, he had the most contention for them, calling them, "You whitewashed tombs, you brood of vipers, you twofold children of hell, you blind guides," he called them. And he told his disciples, he said, "Your righteousness must exceed that of the Pharisees, or you will not enter the kingdom of heaven." So the Pharisees in Yeshua's time, he was very perturbed with them and called them every name in the book and threw the book at them, literally. And here we have Paul, who is a Pharisee. Again, here he is running around killing Christians. And all of a sudden, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, has to knock him off his horse and strike him blind. And he has to be led around like a dog in order to know and understand who the Messiah is. Here's a man who lived in the time of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Messiah, and didn't even know who he was. And even though he had the Torah committed to memory, he could not put the prophecy that is found in the Torah that points directly to the Messiah. He couldn't put these things together. And this is exactly what we see today, my friends. We see these men that are standing behind our pulpits today with more degrees than a thermometer, have more schooling in Aristotle and Socrates and Plato and Gnosticism and all of these types of things, and they don't even know or understand the basic concept, the pivotal concept of the writings of the Apostle Paul. Why is that? Why is that? Well, we're gonna talk a little bit about that and how that happens. How could someone be so educated and just miss the whole point of the book of Acts and the writings of the Apostle Paul? Now, I want to take you to a scripture here. We're going to take a look at Acts 7:59, and I want to just read this to you very quickly, and you can read it with me here. Let me get to that. There we go. Here it is, Acts 7:59. Let's read this together. It says, "And as they were stoning Stephen, he called out, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.' And falling to his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, 'Lord, do not hold this sin against them.' And when he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul, who was Paul, approved of his execution. And there rose on that day great persecution against the church in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul, who was Paul, was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison." So we can see here, my friends, that Paul was not a very nice guy. Being a Pharisee, he really had it out for these Christians, and he really didn't like them at all. And again, it wasn't until our Messiah struck him blind and knocked him off his horse that he finally understood what it was that he was doing. And I find that very profound, that someone with such education would not have known who the Messiah was. But again, today, we see that exact same thing going on time and time again. Now, I want to take us to another scripture very quickly, and this is the warning that Peter gives. We talked about this again in the book of Romans, but we're going to talk about it again before we get into the book of Acts for those of you who may be just joining us brand new and have never heard this information before. This is what the Apostle Peter tells us about the writings of Paul. He gives us a warning, if you will, and we find this in 2 Peter 3:16, and he says this. He says, "There are some things in them," speaking of Paul's writings, "that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and the unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do the other scriptures." My friends, I would submit to you that Christianity itself is off its hinges because they have been ignorant and unstable, and have twisted to their own destruction the writings of the Apostle Paul, as they do the other scriptures. Peter continues to warn us. He says, "You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability. So here we have the Apostle Peter giving us a warning and telling us, you know, the ignorant and the unstable are going to twist the writings of Paul to their own destruction. This is a profound warning, and we can know and we can understand that this is exactly what the Gnostics were doing, and the Gnostics, as they entered into the church, and the Epicureans and many of these other different people that were trying to blend Christianity with Gnosticism and with their old religions. Many of these religions were just literally hundreds and hundreds of different religions. They were people worshiping Dionysus and people worshiping the stars and the sun and astrologers. And they had the Gnostics, you had the Epicureans, you had all kinds of people that were into witchcraft. And we even see Paul and Peter having to deal with people that were into witchcraft and these things. All of this will evolve through the book of Acts, and we'll see a lot of this going on in the book of Acts. So it is an interesting time that Paul and Peter and the apostles are living in. And again, they have all of this Hellenistic, all of these Hellenistic gods and the Greek gods and all of this kind of stuff, and Zeus, and statues are just on every corner. People have all kinds of different things that they're into and all kinds of things that they're worshiping. And these are the things that the apostles are trying to pull people out of and to help them know and to understand the true message of the gospel message of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and who the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob really is, and whose image that they are created in. Again, the book of Acts, extremely important for us to know and to understand. Now, Paul, of course, has been accused almost single-handedly of fracturing the church, the Christian church, and into different denominations and charters of denominations, because each of these different denominational charters of men have picked and chosen different statements that Paul has made in his writings, and they have turned these select statements into their own denominational belief, their own doctrine, their own theology. And they have turned it into a denomination. And when you create a denomination, you need something a little bit different than everybody else is teaching. If you're teaching the same thing that everybody else is teaching, you don't have another denomination. And you therefore do not have dominion over the lay people of that dominion. And that's what it's all about. It's a Nicolaitan belief that there has to be a charter of men that are over the lay people, over the congregation. And this is by no means is this the way that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, wanted it to be. And we find him saying very clearly in the book of Matthew, he says, call no man rabbi, for you are all brothers, and you have one teacher, the teacher who's in heaven. He says, call no man your father on this earth, for you have one father who is in heaven. Again, speaking of a spiritual father. And he says, call no man your instructor, for you have one instructor, the Christ. And this is this. They didn't like to hear this. They don't like those types of things, and you don't hear them repeating those scriptures very often. In fact, they try to not even bother with those scriptures. They slide and skirt all the way around them, doing a little sidestep, if you will. But this is what has happened. And you have many atheists and many agnostics who will look at the writings of the Apostle Paul, and they will see that they are very hard to understand, just as Peter said in 2 Peter 3:16. So they'll look at the writings of Paul, and they'll see that Paul says very clearly, on one hand, he says, do we nullify the law by our faith? He says, absolutely not. We uphold the law in Romans 3:31. And then he turns around and he says, all who are under the law are under a curse. So it sounds like Paul's teaching two different doctrines. It sounds like he's schizophrenic and that he's teaching two different doctrines. And in fact, we find in the book of Acts that Paul is actually accused of preaching against the law. And James really kind of comes down on him and kind of chastises him a little bit. And we'll see that later on in the book of Acts as well. So the book of Acts really does define a lot about Paul. It really defines his Jewishness. It really defines his walk. It defines who he was, where he came from, how he started out, and everything that we need to know about Paul is in the book of Acts. And this is very, very important for us to understand. So one of the things about the book of Acts that's important to understand is the history of the Apostle Paul. Now, many of our modern-day pastors, priests, bishops, and popes have bloodied their hands and knees on the writings of the Apostle Paul. They continuously trip and fall and stumble at every turn, and they have a hard time really explaining all the scriptures and being able to reconcile all the scriptures together because they do not understand the writings of the Apostle Paul. And again, men with more degrees than a thermometer have fallen and continue to teach others to fall because of their bought and paid for, store-bought education that they have and their anointing by men and not having the anointing of Yahweh God the Father. Never really falling to their knees and praying and asking Yahweh God to teach them and to give them the discernment to understand. Rather, going to a professor standing in some college somewhere and learning his opinion about how he was spoon-fed, what someone else was spoon-fed, what someone else was spoon-fed, what someone else was spoon-fed. And this is the trap that we have gotten into with today's modern-day version of churchianity. And everybody just believes that they can come into church on the wrong day of the week and listen to some guy they barely know preach out of the back half of the book while programming them not to read the first half of the book, and it's all good, and then they go home, everybody feels good, and they say, I'm a Christian. In the meantime, they're fed all of this malarkey about once saved, always saved, and dispensational grace, and the pre-tribulation rescue, and all of these things that are found nowhere in Scripture. And we can know that and understand that if we just read the text. So it is important for us to know and to understand a little bit about the book of Acts before we get in it. This is where it all started, and even in the book of Acts, we can see that these Gnostics, these people that were written about in Jude, read the book of Jude, we were warned that these people would enter into the flock and scatter the flock, and they would turn the gospel of our Messiah into lasciviousness. And again, this is exactly what has happened and is still going on right now. Peter, as far back as 48 A.D., who walked with Jesus and was perplexed by the writings of Paul himself, and even Paul's own audience, we find, again, accuse him of preaching against the law and telling people not to circumcise their children. And James really kind of gets on him about this, and there is a penalty that Paul has to pay that we see later on in the book of Acts. We will see this as well. Now, why in the world are Paul's writings in the book of Acts and through his epistles throughout the New Testament or the Brit Hadashah, why are they, do you suppose, so difficult to understand? I want us to know this and I want us to understand this. Why are they so difficult to understand? Let's take a look at Matthew 3:10 and let's see if we can find out exactly what may be the reason for Paul's writings not being clear, not being concise, and being so difficult to understand. Why is that? Well, why did our Messiah speak in parables? You know, the apostles asked our Messiah this very thing. He says, why do you make it so difficult for these people to learn? Why do you speak to them in parables? Let's listen to his reply. Matthew 13:10, it's asked. It said, the disciples came to him and they said, why do you speak to them in parables? And he answered them, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For to the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing, they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, You will indeed hear, but never understand. And you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see, and did not see it, and to hear what you hear, and did not hear it. So here we get a little bit better idea of why the Holy Spirit was guiding Paul to speak the way he spoke and to teach the way he taught. Again, leaving questions here and there and making it sound like he was for the law one minute and against the law the next minute. What was he talking about? How was this all supposed to be fit together? Again, we have to really study to show ourselves approved as we were commanded. We need to understand the context of the writings of the Apostle Paul, where he was, the audience that he had, the battles that he was facing, the many different religions that were out there and what those religions believed in and what Paul was trying to talk them out of in order to understand the writings of the Apostle Paul properly. So I think this gives us some insight as to why our Messiah allowed Paul to speak the way that he spoke. And many people did misunderstand him. Now, that leads us to Marcion of Sinope. Now, Marcion of Sinope was alive around 144 AD. And he came to the Bishop of Rome, and he decided that he was going to proclaim that we needed a New Testament. Because at this point in time, there was no New Testament. There wasn't a New Testament until about 150 AD. So for 150 years at least, the apostles and those Christian believers of the early church, all they had was the Torah and the Tanakh. That's all they had. They didn't have a New Testament as we presume that they did. And we know this from history. So we know when these books were written, we know when they came out, we know through historians what was going on in that time, and we can know and we can understand that all they had was indeed the Torah. Now, Marcion of Sinope was a very interesting individual. He believed that the old God, the God of Israel, was an old God, and that the new God was Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, had come. He was the new God in town. And the old God of the Israelites had nothing to do with Yeshua, the new God. And he tried at every turn to separate Yeshua, Jesus, from his Jewishness and Paul from his Jewishness and tried to completely cut the Israelites out of the picture. So this is what he does. He goes to the Bishop of Rome. He wants to pen a new Bible to have this canon put together. And he believes that Paul is the only one that can preach the gospel message. So he puts together this Bible, and in this Bible, he basically just has the writings of Paul and cuts out the complete book of Acts. No book of Acts at all in his Bible. And for those of us who know better, I mean, we laugh and we think, well, that must have been silly. You know, how could that have ever happened? But today, my friends, I would submit to you that we more today have a church, the church of Paul, rather than the church of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Most of our churches today concentrate on the Apostle Paul more than they concentrate on Yeshua, the Messiah. And this is a sad, sad thing to see. And again, taking his writings out of context, and in different things that he had written in his writings that are hard to understand, that the ignorant and the unstable would twist to their own destruction, as warned by Peter, and they make their own denominations out of these things. And again, we know that we have over 5,000 different Christian denominations around the world, all splintered into 5,000 different pieces, different shards of glass, because men have done this. And they have done this throughout time. Even the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes have done this. And there were many scriptures about the lying pen of the scribes. And they were writing their laws over God's laws. And, of course, Christianity has done the exact same thing. We have overwritten his Sabbaths. We've overwritten his feast days. We've overwritten his commandments, his precepts, his moedim, his appointments. All of it we have overwritten. The very anniversary of the death of our Messiah, we have forgotten it and covered it up and now call it Easter. And again, a pagan name that does not even belong anywhere in the scriptures and is not found anywhere in the scriptures. And for you King James folks out there, we have more than enough evidence to know and understand that the word Easter does not belong in the King James Bible. It is what we would call a blooper. And there's many reasons why to believe this. And it all boils down to the facts if you really take the time to look at that. But that is another study. We won't get into that right now. But again, we see the same things going on that Marcion of Sinope had started, even in the early church. And these Gnostics were coming in, and all of these different people were coming into the church and trying to disassemble the gospel before it ever even got off the ground. And it is amazing that the truth of God's word still can be found today by those who decide that they want to study to show themselves approved, who understand the greatest commandment, and that is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your strength. And that the second is like it, to love your brother as yourself. So, Marcion pens this version of the Bible without the Old Testament in it, doesn't have the Old Testament in it. And his new found Bible leaves out the book of Acts and the apostles and only includes the writings of the apostle Paul. Now, the bishops see this and they just go crazy. This is just ridiculous. And they don't want to be involved in this at all. You know, they are immediately putting this Bible down and just don't want to have anything to do with it. And the bishops, basically what they do is they proclaim that 10 of Paul's letters, including the book of Acts, is indeed authoritative and useful for instructing the church. So the bishops kind of shun this whole thing with Marcion, and they kind of get him out of the way, and this kind of falls flat, and you don't really hear much about the Bible of Marcion. But we do hear about it through different historians like Tertullian. Now, Tertullian was born around 145 AD, and he wrote this about Marcion in a work that he appropriately entitled Against Marcion. He wrote this, and I quote, he says, "You must show us first of all who Paul was. What was he before he became an apostle? How did he become an apostle?" So we find this in the writings of hidden in the writings of Tertullian, again born in 145 AD, telling us about this ridiculous Marcion fellow who just absolutely obliterated the Bible and just got rid of the Old Testament. And again, I with great sorrow in my heart, I hate to say it, but that's exactly what our churches are doing today. They don't want you to read the Old Testament. And if you read the Old Testament, and if you believe in what the Old Testament says, and you know and understand that everything in the Old Testament points to Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, from the book of Genesis, where we find the Word, to the book of John in the New Testament, who says the Word was made flesh, who came down to preach among men. He was the Word who was found in the very beginning of Genesis. We find the Passover and those who were going through the Exodus. They had no idea that putting the blood above the doorpost to keep the angel of death away from them, they had no idea what that signified. They had no idea that that signified the blood of the Messiah, the one who was prophesied to come. They have no idea when they were keeping the Passover why it was that they were selecting a lamb that had no blemishes on it and it was perfect, because it signified the perfect human being, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, who never broke the law and who was the Son of God. He was without blemish. And they never understood why it was that they had to take that lamb home with them for 4 days before they actually had to take it to the temple and have it slaughtered. Why would God have them take that lamb home and get used to that, and the kids play with it and get attached to that animal, and then take it to the temple to be slaughtered for Passover? It signifies the love that he had for his only begotten son, who he offered up as a propitiation for the sins of the world. All of these things, my friend, he was the Passover lamb. He was the propitiation for our sin. He was the reason that they put the blood above the doorpost. He was, even if you look at the layout of the temple and where the showbread is and where the Holy of Holies is and all of this points to Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. And we see time and time and time again these prophecies and these pointers and these things that are all of these spring feast days, from the Passover to first fruits to the Feast of Unleavened Bread to Pentecost to all of these spring feast days, all point to the Messiah's first coming. And of course, the fall feast days all point to his return, his second return, his second coming. But you see, they didn't know that when they were doing these things. They had no idea. Now, this is exactly why when our Jewish brothers and sisters know the truth about Christianity, and they know the truth that there is no such thing as Christmas and these pagan garbage and Easter and all of this garbage and everything else, they understand who the Messiah was. They know and they understand, once they see all of these things, once they know that God's laws do still stand, the laws have never been done away with. It's exactly like what the Apostle Paul told us in Romans 3:31. He asks the question, do we then nullify the law by our faith? He says, absolutely not. On the contrary, we uphold the law. So we know this, and when our Jewish friends and brothers and our sisters see this and they know this, they immediately know that the Messiah, indeed, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, was the Messiah. And many of them, my friends, are coming. Many of them are coming. Let's take a look. We do want to take a look at another scripture here very quickly. Let's take a look at Matthew 5:17. And I just want us to read this before we get into the book of Acts, because this all plays into the book of Acts and the gospel message of our Messiah. This is written in red, words from the mouth, the breath, the words, the voice of our Messiah. He says this: do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them, to do them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Now, this is extremely important. This is a direct statement coming directly from our Messiah. I did not come to abolish the law. I came to fulfill it. And he doesn't. So we know that fulfill does not mean do away with or abolish, because he uses abolish in that sentence. He came to do one and not do the other. I did not come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come to fulfill them, to do them. And he even nails it down tight when he says in 5:18, for truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Now, my friends, unless our Messiah is a liar or a drunk, or he's just forgetful, or he's schizophrenic, or, I mean, you can think of any kind of excuse that you want to think of. But unless he's one of those crazy people, or just a blatant liar, then we must go with what our Messiah has told us in the scriptures, that he did not come to abolish the law or the prophets, and that heaven and earth would pass away before the crossing of a T or the dotting of an I of the law would pass away. And he says all things must be accomplished. Now, my friends, all things are not accomplished. We still have quite a ways to go before his coming kingdom and before all things are accomplished. Can we agree on that much? I hope so. So This is just extremely important for us to know and to understand as we move into the book of Acts, to know and understand what our Messiah said about the law, to know and understand what Paul said about the law. And I want to bring one thing up here. As we have studied the book of Romans, we already know the proclamations of the Apostle Paul. And I just want to share those with you. For those of you who have not been with us through the book of Romans, these are just some of the proclamations that Paul made about the law in the book of Romans that we just got done studying. Let's look at those. This is from chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 6, chapter 7, chapter 8, and chapter 8 again down here at the bottom. What does he say? This is Paul, the very one that most pastors today will tell you did away with the law. What does he say? Romans 2:13, "For it's not the hearers of the law who will be righteous before God, but the doers of the law who will be justified." Romans 3:31, we just talked about that. He asks the most important question in all of Christianity. Right here it is, Romans 3:31. "Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law." Romans chapter 6, he says it again. He says, "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound?" He says, "By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it?" What is sin, my friends? According to the word of God, according to the scriptures, the actual definition of the word sin is the transgression of the law. That's what sin is. It is the transgression of the law. Romans 7:12, he says, "So the law is holy, and the commandment is holy and righteous and good." So this doesn't sound like Paul is saying that the law is a curse or bondage to me. Does it sound like that to you? How about Romans 8:7? This is where he really nails it down. He says, "For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God." What does he have to say to get us to know and to understand that Paul was not preaching against the law of God? It is important for us to know this. Romans 8:2 tells us what it was that our Messiah did do away with, and that was the penalty of the law. The penalty of the law, if you broke the law, that was sin. And what is the wages of sin? The wages of sin is death. What did our Messiah do away with? He did away with the penalty of the law, not the law itself. It says very clearly, Romans 8:2, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law." Is that what it says? That's not what it says. It says, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death." Sin and death was the penalty of the law. When you broke the law, this was the penalty. It was sin. You created sin, and it was death. Because of that, you had to be put to death, or you had to kill an animal or shed some blood to atone for that sin, for breaking that law. So we can see clearly here that the Apostle Paul was not teaching and preaching against the laws of God. And it's so very important for us to know and to understand these things. And I just wanted to kind of bring this to your attention, just in case you had not studied the book of Romans with us. Just to know and understand this as we are moving into the book of Acts. Now, I also want to give you some other pointers here. In the book of Acts, some things that you may not know. And these are just interesting facts that I have here about the book of Acts. What, if you had to say that the book of Acts was about something, what would you say the book of Acts was about? Well, the book of Acts is about Yahweh God the Father in the form of the Holy Spirit. And why do I say that? Well, I want you to listen to this. Now, the Holy Spirit never gets enough airtime in Christianity today. You hardly ever hear about the Holy Spirit. You hear about Yeshua, you hear about Yahweh, you hear about all of these things, but you don't hear about the all-important Holy Spirit that Yeshua said would be sent in his place to remind us of him. Okay? The Holy Spirit is mentioned in the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament, 88 times in the whole book. Okay? Now listen to this. Now I want you to listen to this. So let's kind of divide up how many times the Holy Spirit is brought up and mentioned in each one of the books. Okay? In the book of Matthew, the Holy Spirit is mentioned five times. Okay? The book of Matthew, five times. In the book of Mark, it's mentioned four times. In the book of Luke, it's mentioned 13 times. In the book of John, it's mentioned three times. In all of Paul's epistles, the Holy Spirit is mentioned 16 times. Okay? In the book of Hebrews, he's mentioned five times, and in Peter mentions the Holy Spirit twice. Okay? Now, with that information, armed with that information, the Holy Spirit is not mentioned in the book of Revelation, but it is mentioned in the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit is mentioned in the book of Acts 40 times. 40 times. More than anywhere else. It is mentioned in the book of Acts 40 times. And between Luke's two books, the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles, he mentions the Holy Spirit 53 times. So do you think that in Luke's mind, the Holy Spirit that was given at Pentecost, do you think that that played an important part in what was going on planting the early church? You bet it was. You bet it was. And he knew it. And he knew it. And it is something that we don't believe today. And over and over and over at Holy Impact Ministries, we tell people, you know, if you're not praying to him for the discernment to understand these writings, you're not going to get it. You're not going to understand. It is only those who say, all right, I want to know the truth. I don't care about all this other garbage. I don't care about this denomination, that denomination. I don't care what charter of men that's on every street corner. I don't care. I just want to know the truth. When you fall to your knees and when you turn to the east to Jerusalem and when you pray to Yahweh God the Father and you say, Father, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, just give me the truth. Let me know the truth, and I will do it. No matter what it cost, I will do it. This is when the discernment is given. This is when he will give the discernment. But you've got to let go of everything else. And you've got to say, okay, if none of this stuff is true, then Father, show me, give me the discernment. Give me the discernment. Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil, Father, and show me the truth, and he will show it to you. And so many men of God today are so busy going from class to class to class, sitting in front of professor after professor after professor. They don't get on their knees. They don't ask for the discernment. They think that they're just going to buy that education. They're going to be anointed by men who say that they have the truth, who have never gotten on their knees and asked for the discernment, or they wouldn't be lost in the first place. These are the people who are going to have the truth, my friends. It's going to be those who ask him and no one else. And that's why our Messiah spoke in parables. And he said very clearly, he said, to whom who has, he will be given more. Why? Because he has been searching for the truth. If you've been searching for the truth and you have some truth, you will be given more truth. And he continues and he says, he who has none will have less. Even what he has is going to be taken away from him. He's talking about the one that's all interested in football and baseball and basketball and Two and a Half Men and an American Idol. And it doesn't, he could care less about the truth of the gospel. It doesn't even care. To him, even what he has is going to be taken away. So we can know and understand these things if we'll just read the scripture and we'll just understand. Ask for the discernment. What is he talking about? What is he talking about? Again, the Holy Spirit mentioned 40 times in the book of Acts alone. So it's important for us to know and to understand these things. And as we read through Luke's writings in the book of Acts, we also find that there was no doubt in Luke's mind that the God of Christianity indeed is the God of Israel. That is who he is. It is who he always has been. And there is no separation. And we have pastors and priests and bishops and even popes now preaching and teaching replacement theology, that the Christian church has overrun the Israelites, and there is no more Israelites, and those nasty Jews that hung Jesus on the cross. My friends, these people are so lost they couldn't find their way out of a paper bag. It is unbelievable when you read the book of Acts and when you read the gospel message to believe such profanity. We are profaning the name of Yahweh God the Father by believing and teaching these wicked, wicked things. And we need to tell our brothers this thing. You know, we need, some of our brothers out there have so much truth, but they just ruin it with the deception that they are teaching. And the idea that the Christian church has replaced the Israelites, and that we're once saved, always saved. That is the biggest lie ever concocted by mankind. And we'll see that in the book of Romans. I want us to see something, or I'm sorry, the book of Acts is what we're looking at. Now, I want us to see this also. Let me take you over here very quickly. I have another one for you, Galatians 3:27, and I want you to see this, and I want you to know this and understand this. It's very, very important. Let me get there very quickly. I think I have it bookmarked here. Let's see. That should be E5. Here it is. I don't know why Matthew's in there. Galatians 3:27. I want to read this. It says, "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is not even male and female, for you all are one in Christ Jesus, the Messiah. And if you are Christ's," hear this now, "if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise," says the Apostle Paul. Now, how in the world could a pastor preach against this? How could a pastor preach against this? There is not even male or female. We're all one in the eyes of Yahweh God the Father. We are one body, one olive tree, one nation, a nation of holy priests that have been chosen out of the darkness to proclaim his marvelous light. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, we are part of the body of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you, my friends, and you can look for it yourself, there is no one on the face of the earth that Yahweh God the Father has ever called his people other than the Israelites. And it is the Israelites that brought forth our Messiah. He was a Jew, and it is the blood of a Jew that covers the transgressions of the whole world. And we need to know this, and we need to understand this. He came from the house of David, from the tribe of Judah. It's important that we know these things, my friends, because if we don't, we're not going to get these writings of Paul correct at all. We don't have a chance of understanding them. The book of Acts puts the epistles of both Peter and Paul kind of on the same footwork as well. We'll see this throughout the Bible. And here's something very interesting that you may not have picked up on. We find that in the book of Acts, the first things that both Peter and Paul did was they healed a cripple. Both men, the first miracle that they did was to heal a cripple. We also find that Peter healed merely by casting his shadow. He healed. And Paul healed by someone who just had a rag or a cloth that he had touched. He healed. Very similar. Both men encountered witchcraft in the book of Acts, and we'll see that as we go along as well, along with Gnosticism and Epicureanism and all of these Hellenistic gods and statues. Both men had to deal with witchcraft. Both men were also supernaturally rescued from prison. So interesting things between Peter and Paul. And you'll see these apostles as they move forward and as they fight to contend for the faith as we are commanded. A lot of the same things happen to these men. And it is an extremely interesting book. I'm just gonna say this, my friends, if you miss out on the book of Acts and you miss out where the church was born, you're going to absolutely miss out on the gospel message. If we don't understand this right here, right now, right in the beginning, in the book of Acts, we're going to get it wrong for the rest of the Brit Hadashah. We're going to get it wrong. That's why it's so important to get it right here, right now, and to understand the writings of the Apostle Paul and the apostles, all of them, in the book of Acts. We're going to see some amazing things on this journey, and we invite you to stay with us. We invite you to be with us each and every Wednesday. We're going to take our time with this. We're not going to rush through it because it's that important. It's that important that we know how to defend the faith. And I want you to know how to defend the faith, because if you don't know how to defend the faith and you don't know how to give an answer, you're going to be run over. You're going to be deceived. And they're going to run over you with all kinds of these scriptures that they have cherry-picked, that they use as a candy stick scripture, and they're going to try to make you believe what they believe instead of what is written. And again, the only way we can know this is to ask him for the discernment to understand. And if you will do that, you will indeed understand. Again, I just want to thank you very much for spending your time with me here today. Again, this video is free. Everything we do at Holy Impact Ministries is free. You can freely download it. It's free for the taking. You can burn it to a DVD. You can share it with your friends. If you like this video, if this has been a blessing to you, please like it. Click the like button. Share the video. This helps more people to see the video, and it helps the YouTube will advertise the video the more likes that it has. So you can help us out by doing these things, get this video information out, and invite people to this study on the book of Acts. In the meantime, I just want to say thank you again for joining us. If you're still with us, I know you have a thirst for truth. And this is exactly how we are supposed to worship Yahweh God the Father, in spirit and in truth. And again, I want to commend you for sticking it out with us here on this Bible study. In the end, I pray that the hand of God would be upon you and your family until we meet again, and that the grace and the peace of Yahweh God the Father would be upon you. God bless, and shalom.
If you were blessed by this teaching, please consider helping us reach the nations by making a donation today. Thank you, and shalom.